Hey, my name is Jackson Moser, and I have the privilege of serving as pastor at Kirkwood Church here in Clarksville, Tennessee. We want to say thank you for stopping by our YouTube channel, and we pray that with the sermon that you're getting ready to watch, that it would stir your heart for the Lord, that it would stir your heart for His bride, the church, and that it would stir your heart for His mission of reaching the nations with the good news of Jesus Christ. We do want to invite you to our church gatherings. If you don't have a church family, join us this coming Sunday. Check out our website for the latest service times, and we do hope to see you soon. Grace and peace to you, friends. As we continue in our series through the book of Ecclesiastes, this teacher that we've been learning from now turns to consider the meaninglessness of life's seasons in time apart from a clear understanding of God's role in it and submission to Christ. Let's look at the text together, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, beginning in verse 1, and we'll go through the first part of 15. The teacher writes this: "There is an occasion for everything and a time for every activity under heaven. A time to give birth and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace and a time to avoid embracing. A time to search and a time to count as lost, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What does the worker gain for all his struggles? I've seen the task that God has given the children of Adam to keep them occupied. He has made everything appropriate in its time. He's also put eternity in their hearts, but no one can discover the work God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better than for them to rejoice and enjoy the good life. It's the gift of God whenever anyone eats, drinks, and enjoys all his efforts. I know that everything God does will last forever. There is no adding to it or taking from it. God works so that people will be in awe of him. Whatever is, has already been, and whatever will be, already is." I'll say, "This is the word of the Lord," and you'll say, "Thanks be to God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our text is broken down into two different parts. Part one is the teacher's poem on time, and part two is the teacher's teaching on time. The poem in verses 1 through 8 demonstrates, number one for us this morning, the meaninglessness of time. And you may say, "Well, Pastor, I think the poem's kind of nice. It's rhythmic. It kind of encompasses all of life from beginning to end. It's got some nice parallels in it. It helps me make sense of the seasons that I walk through." Some of you may remember the old song, "Turn, Turn, Turn," written by Peter Seeger and performed by the Byrds. The song had such a positive and uplifting, joyful tone to it. And yet, friends, I would suggest to you this morning that they missed the point that the teacher was trying to make. I say that because of verse 9, where the teacher begins his expose by saying, "What does the worker gain for all his struggles?" That is to say that we go through all these seasons of time, this and that, up and down, highs and lows, good times and hard times. And for what? We work, 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 toil, 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 endure, 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 wake up and go to bed not knowing what the day is going to hold for us, ultimately knowing, however, that there is a day coming where we will breathe our last and not wake up on this earth again. And so for what? Isn't it all meaningless? Isn't all the toil and the seasons we face in life, isn't it all ultimately purposeless? Where Seeger failed to rightly capture the teacher's tone and turn, 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 Danny Akin writes that Hootie and the Blowfish got a little bit better with their tune, "Time." Maybe you know it. Here's some of the lyrics. "Time, why do you punish me? Like a wave bashing into the shore, you wash away my dreams. Time, Why do you walk away like a friend with somewhere to go? You left me crying. Can you teach me about tomorrow, all the pain and sorrow, running free because tomorrow's just another day? Time, I don't understand. Killing children in the street, dying for the color red. Time, they're red and blue, washing them in the ocean. Make them new. Maybe their mothers won't cry tonight. Time is wasting time. You're no friend of mine. I don't know where I'm going. I think I'm out of my mind thinking about time. And if I die tomorrow, just lay me in my sleep. Time, you left me standing there like a tree, growing all alone. The wind just stripped me bare. Time without courage and time without fear. It's just wasted, wasted, wasted time. Time, why do you punish me? Now, that's got a bit of a heavier tone to it, doesn't it? And the question the teacher poses in this verse, verse 9, seems to suggest that that tone is a little more what he's after when he thinks about time. The teacher here seems to be echoing his sentiments expressed elsewhere in places like chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, where he writes, "What has been is what will be, and what has been done is what will be done. There's nothing new under the sun." Can anyone say, look, this is new? No, it has already existed in the ages before us. There's no remembrance of those who come before, and of those who will come after, there will also be no remembrance by those who follow them. Or maybe even from the summary statement of the book, chapter 1, verse 14, "I have seen all things that are to be done under the sun and found everything to be futile. A pursuit of the wind." And so then this begs the question, so teacher, what in the world are we supposed to do? What are we supposed to make of the meaningless of time? Are we really supposed to just slug through life, taking it as it comes and waiting until we die? And we would answer, no, friends, of course not. As we look at part two of this text this morning, we understand that there is a way in which we all experience in this life, the various seasons and times, there is a way to make sense that even leads to our rejoicing. What we must learn to do is understand God's timing, appreciate God's timing, and surrender to God's timing. Number two this morning, understand God's timing. And you may say, now wait a second, Pastor, haven't you read Deuteronomy 29, 29, that the hidden things belong to the Lord? Or Isaiah chapter 55, that His ways are higher than our ways and His thoughts are higher than our thoughts? Or even in this very passage, the end of verse 11, no one can discover the work that God has done. So what do you mean, understand God's timing? Well, I would agree with you that there are indeed things that are simply outside of our ability to understand. Things happen, sometimes very awful, horribly tragic things happen, and we ask, why? Matt Chandler says that so often the human experience is summed up in the toddler why phase. Many of you know the why phase, where you just ask why about everything. You know, why? All right, we got to go to the grocery store. Why? Well, because we got to get groceries. Why? Well, because we got to eat. Why? Because we need food to eat. Why? Well, why? Because God made us that way. Well, why? I don't know. Because I said so. That's why. Why? Sometimes we don't get the answer. Sometimes we never find out or understand this side of eternity. Why? The specific answer to why God allows some things to happen and is indeed a mystery. But there are general ways revealed to us in Scripture that we can understand God's timing. Not specific, but general ways we can rightly think about the seasons and the situations that we face in life. The teacher gives us three in our text today. Number one, we can say that God's timing is good. Verse 11 begins by saying, "He has made everything appropriate in its time." Now, for some people, that presents some serious and maybe even intimate questions and problems. Was it good when my parents or sibling or spouse or child suddenly or tragically died? We can think of questions of our own to fill in the blank there of something really bad that happened, and we ask, Why? How can that be good? How can we say that God's timing in that was good, particularly if we contend that God is all-powerful and is sovereign over all things? And this takes us to the age-old question of if God is all-good or benevolent, and if God is all-powerful or omnipotent, why do bad things happen? And we'd answer that question in several ways. Number one, bad things happen because we live in a world that has been totally and radically corrupted by sin. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden in Genesis chapter 3, that didn't just throw a little kink in the hose of reality. That radically and totally corrupted everything. It corrupted how we see and relate to ourselves, how we see and we relate to others, how we see and relate to the world around us. The created order is now out of order, and chaos ensues personally and interpersonally and even cosmically. Bad things happening does not in any way negate God's power or God's goodness. Those things can coexist at the same time. In fact, number two, it's precisely because of God's goodness and because of God's power that anyone has any hope at all. If God were only good but not all-powerful, he would be impotent and unable to actually intervene in any kind of significant or substantial way to provide a means of dealing with this sin-sick world in which we live. And if God were only all-powerful but not all-good, all-benevolent, then although he could intervene, there's no guarantee that he would, and we'd end up with some aloof and uninterested deity somewhere out there just waiting to see how things unfold. Like some twisted version of Love is Blind or some stupid reality TV show. But this is not our God. Because of the revelation of Scripture, we can have hope that while bad things, even horrible, heartbreaking, gut-wrenching things happen, that for those of us in Christ, we can trust and have hope and joy and security in knowing that although we don't have all the details, we do have a God who has indeed written the end from the beginning and is working all things out for His glory and for our good. It may not feel good, friends. It may not seem good, it may not look good, but he is good. And so we can have faith that he is working for good. We can say with the teacher that he has made everything, no matter what I'm going through, whether high or low, difficult or easy, painful or painless, he has made everything appropriate. Literally, the Hebrew word there is beautiful in its time. And so, friends, I hope you find rest and hope in that. That you can look at your life even today, regardless of what you're walking through, just walked out of or getting ready to walk into, and know that God has made this time, this season, appropriate, beautiful. We can sum that up in a word. He has made it good. In this way, we can talk about how God's timing is, number two, it's pointing. Verse 11 continues, he has put eternity into their hearts. That is to say that there is a sense in which everyone, religious or not, Christian or not, understands that this isn't it. I would contend that even the staunchest atheist sometimes wonders late at night, even though they'd never admit it, is this it? Surely there is more than just live and die and go into the ground and decay. This is the right conclusion that the teacher is making and coming to in his writing. We remember all he's done. We remember he's lived for himself. He's amassed and acquired and attained. On and on we could go, rehashing the last 2 weeks of sermons. You know, and yet he's come to the conclusion that all that stuff is meaningless. There's a sense of frustration in that. And there's a sense of frustration that people arrive at when they try this and it leaves them empty. So then they try that and they come to the same result. And then they pursue this and it leaves them longing and so on and so forth. It's maddening. It's frustrating. It's frustrating. Math was never my strong suit, but if we look back at the list in verses 2 through 8 of all the seasons, for every one thing, there is its opposite. In fact, there's 14 pairs. The last time I got my calculator out, 14 plus negative 14 equals what? Zero. Every gain, there's a loss. Every addition, there's a subtraction. We think we can go through this life and it be all daisies and roses and just positive, 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 positive. And yet that's not reality, and that's frustrating to us, and that's the point. This eternity that God has placed in the hearts of every human is going to leave us frustrated until we come to Christ, who makes sense of it all. As Augustine puts it, our hearts are restless until we rest in thee. How many of us have found that to be true? This eternity is pointing to something, no, someone that we were made for. And until we understand and submit to that, we will always be longing, always be frustrated, always be wondering. It's like this. Imagine a friend invites you over to watch a movie, and the movie is going to start at 4 p.m. sharp because there are others coming over and we wait for no one. Well, you get caught in traffic, and it's bad traffic, and you're texting your friend, going to be late. 20 minutes later, still stuck. 30 minutes later, still in traffic. 1 hour goes by. I'm so sorry. This traffic is horrible. I'll be there ASAP. Well, let's say you finally get there 1 hour, 50 minutes, and 18 seconds after the movie has started, and you walk in, you sit on the couch, the movie's playing there in the living room, and the first thing you hear is, "No, I am your father." And you hear Luke let out that cringy, "No!" He falls through the tunnels of the spacecraft, finally be picked up by Leia and Chewie and the Millennium Falcon and be chased away by Imperial starfighters. You watch as the movie closes and Luke and Leia are headed one direction in a rebellion carrier, and Lando and Chewie fly off in the Falcon, and Vader prepares to end the rebellion once and for all. And although, let's say you've been living under a rock and you've never seen this movie, you didn't see episode 4, A New Hope. You didn't see the 1 hour, 50 minutes, and 17 seconds leading up to it. Yes, I did my research. Although all of that is true, you know somehow there's more to the story. This isn't how it ends. This can't be it. And friends, I think the way that God uses and works and sets time is a lot like that. We may not have all the details or answers, but the seasons and situations that we walk through are directional markers pointing to something bigger and something greater, pointing to God and His purposes in this life. We can indeed confidently say that this moment of joy that I'm experiencing, or this moment of sorrow that I'm walking through, they are not ends in and of themselves. They are pointing me to the fact that there is something so much greater, so much more beautiful unfolding, and God is inviting me into that. You know, we often quote Romans 8:28. It says, "And we know that God works all things together for those who love God and are called according to His purposes." Put that verse on coffee cups and t-shirts and Instagram bios, and we should. It's a beautiful verse. But if we just pluck that out, we can very easily slip into a kind of health, wealth, and prosperity gospel, perhaps, or at least a very watered-down understanding of some important doctrines related to God and His character and His nature, or the doctrine of sin and evil, or others. When we think about Romans 8:28, we also want to keep in mind Romans 8:29. Which teaches us that God acts for a purpose, and that purpose is so that we might be conformed into the image of His Son. That is, that He really does work all things together, but He works it all together so that we might be more like Jesus. As God works in the various times we walk through, the seasons and circumstances and situations we face and endure, God is an active agent so that those things end up pointing us to Jesus and making us more like Him. That is to say that God's timing is number three. It's purposeful. Look at the end of verse 14. Chapter 3, verse 14 ends by saying, "God works so that people will be in awe of Him." My goodness, we should commit that one to memory. God works so that people will be in awe of Him. God works why? So that I'll be happy? Is that what it says? So I'll be set up? So I'll be well off? No, there is no I in that. right? God works so that people will be in awe of him. He is the one who gets the praise. He is the one who gets the glory. He is the one who is to be worshiped. And what that means for you and for me is that we can look at our life. We can pull back from what feels so immediate and be reminded of the fact that regardless of what season of time I'm in right now, God is working so that he will receive the greatest glory possible. Think about passages like Matthew chapter 5, where he says, "You, disciples, followers, are the light of the world." He ends by saying, "Let your light shine." Why? So that people will praise you. So that people will platform you. So that people will give you lots of money or stuff or accolades or recognition. No, so that people may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. We shine, friends. We walk, we endure, we persist, we trust, we take one more step even when we think there's no way out or the season will never end. Why? So that God receives the glory and the praise and the honor that he is rightly due. God works so that people will be in awe of him. Friends, as those who know God, for those of us in Christ, let me encourage you this morning, don't waste this season. Are you in a season of celebrating? Use it to honor the Lord. Are you in a season of mourning? Use it to honor the Lord. Are you in a season of rejoicing? Give glory to God. Are you in a season of wrestling? Give glory to God. Are you in a season of ease and comfort? Give thanks to God. Are you in a season of trial and difficulty? Well, give thanks to him in that as well. Why? Because you know that God is moving and he's acting and he is involved in your life so that people will stand in awe of him. How does this happen? Well, in part, it happens when we, main point number two this morning, learn to appreciate God's timing. Listen to verses 12 through 13 again. "I know that there is nothing better than for them to rejoice and to enjoy the good life. It's also the gift of God whenever anyone eats, drinks, and enjoys all his efforts." What the teacher has come to learn is that all the striving and grinding and hustling and toiling, all that stuff is ultimately meaningless. When that stuff is viewed as an end in and of itself, it's pointless, it's futile, it's chasing after the wind. But when we learn to view everything, every season we walk through the lens of the loving Father's plan, all of a sudden we come to appreciate whatever it is we're walking through. All of a sudden we can enjoy creation rather than worship creation. You see the difference? We learn because we understand that God is sovereign and in control of all things that happens, that the things that I work for and the things that I come into and the things that I receive, I can enjoy those simply as gifts from God rather than falling prey to worshiping those things because I've made them idols in my life. When we view it through the Father's loving plan. At a previous church that I worked at, I was hired and brought on staff, and within about 8 or 10 months, most of the other staff that was there when I was hired left for one reason or another, and I found myself in a desperate situation. It was myself and two other full-time staff members, essentially, and ministry-related staff members, and we began the process of a pastor search process because the senior pastor had left, and it became a disaster. I mean, it just kept going on and on and on and on, and horrible, tragic decisions were made that led to awful problems. And I just remember finding myself at several times through the 18 grueling months that we walked through that thinking, my line in the sand has been drawn. If this continues to persist, I'll have to leave. Morally, I'll have to leave. Ethically, I'll have to leave. For the sake of my health and my family's health, I'll have to step away because it's not working. No matter how many times I wondered and I asked God, why am I here? What's the point of this? This surely isn't good. Like, you're not being glorified through this. I'm miserable. What's the point of all of this? Now, friends, Now I'm able to look back on that time and can see so many of the lessons that God was teaching me. How he was shaping me, how he was preparing me for the next assignment, how he was leading me to trust him more even when I didn't have all of the answers. And so now when I find myself in an uncomfortable or unfortunate season or situation, I look back on times like that and I can appreciate and trust that even though I don't have the answers, I know God is working. And one day, maybe not even in this lifetime, but one day I'll understand. I'll see what he was doing, how he was moving, where he was acting. We have to appreciate God's timing. Number three, we have to learn how to surrender to God's timing. Verse 14 through 15, I know that everything God does will last forever. There is no adding to it or taking from it. God works so that people will be in awe of him. Whatever is, has already been. And whatever will be, already is. From these verses, we come to understand that God's will, his plan is set. There is no changing it. And we can rebel and resist and rail against that idea. Or we can humbly surrender to the fact and learn to walk joyfully with the Lord through whatever circumstances we find ourselves in. We might think here of the words of Joseph when responding to his brothers. Many of us know the story, right? And what does Joseph say when the story's kind of coming to a culmination? He says, "You intended this for evil, but God intended it for good, for the welfare of his people." Through Joseph's story, we learn that God uses both pain and pleasure as a part of his sovereign plan. Joseph, one of the youngest of Israel's sons, hated by his brothers, sold cruelly into slavery, works his way up through the ranks, is wrongfully accused of coming after Potiphar's wife, so he's put in prison, and he stays in prison for all those years, finally to interpret Pharaoh's dreams, and he's given a new position of authority, the second most greatest amount of authority in the land. And it's just this beautiful story where if we pull back, we can learn so many different lessons about how God uses everything that we walk through, that his will for our lives is already set, and he's using every bit of it for his glory and for our good. And again, that invites us to look then at our own stories, at our own lives, and ask, what kind of time are we in? What kind of season are we in right now? And regardless of how we answer that question, we can know for sure that whatever it is ultimately a part of his good, perfect, pleasing will that leads to his glory. Once again, drawing from Danny Aiken, he likens so many of life's circumstances to a piece of jagged glass. You know, that piece of glass is dangerous. That piece of glass in isolation can cut and hurt and do harm. That piece of jagged glass, I mean, we know at one point in time it was a part of something bigger, but you pull that out into isolation and you're just looking at that and you wonder, what in the world would this be used for? How could this be used? I mean, it's broken, it's jagged, it might hurt other people, and yet what if that piece of jagged glass was created that way by a sovereign, powerful, good, loving creator to be placed into a perfect position in a beautiful piece of stained glass? Stained glass that tells a story of brokenness turned into beauty, of ashes turned into something glorious. So often, friends, when it comes to time, all we think about is we get so close, so up close and personal and intimate to the one thing that we're walking through that we fail to pull back and try to get God's perspective on how he's using it all. And he's inviting us to surrender to his will, to his way, and allow him to work for his glory. Friends, the reality that we face in a post-fall, pre-return world is that we will face difficult times. We will face hard times. We will face times that we don't understand. And although we may be tempted to despair, we don't have to. Because although the time of when God rights every wrong and restores all things, although that time has not come, the Bible tells us that when time was fulfilled, God sent Christ into the world. That's Galatians 4:4. When the time was fulfilled, when the time had come to completion, God sent Christ to bear the curse for us. When Jesus came into the world, he came to experience every season and circumstance that we do, so that now we have a great high priest who is not unable to sympathize with us, but able in every way to sympathize with our weakness, with our frailty. For Jesus, just like for us, there's a time for him to be born, a time for him to grow up, a time for him to begin and to set out. For Jesus, there was a time to build up, a time to celebrate, a time for him to mourn the loss of a friend, a time for him to teach and a time to rebuke, a time for him to heal the sick and a time for him to walk away, a time for him to pray and a time for him to be wrongly tried, brutally beaten, and crucified on a cross, even though he was sinless. He took on himself all of life's pain and suffering, and he did it so that you and I and whoever may call on his name might be saved. So that regardless of what we face in this life, we can have joy and confidence knowing that this is not the end. This isn't all that there is. In fact, the suffering that we may experience now, the ups and the downs, the highs and the lows, Paul says it all pales in comparison to the future weight of glory to come. Glory that awaits all of those in Christ Jesus. And so, friends, my final encouragement this morning is to think less, to look less at the times we may find ourselves in, and look rather to our glorious Savior. To think less, to look less in the season that we find ourselves in now, and to look more, to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Friends, would we look to that Jesus regardless of the times, seasons that we find ourselves walking through, and then we enjoy the good life. Then we're able to rejoice through it all. You know, Paul says that's God's will for us in Christ Jesus, that we would rejoice. And I pray that we would, only because we know him. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this morning, and we thank you for this word from the wise teacher of Ecclesiastes. And God, it's my prayer that we as a church, as a family of believers, would learn to indeed surrender to your timing, that we would trust you in all things, that even as we walk through difficult times, times of confusion, times of doubt, times of wrestling, times of not understanding, that we would trust you and that we would submit our lives to you, knowing, fully confident that you are at work. God, would you give us a right biblical understanding of the times? Would you give us, Lord, as we've thought about in previous weeks, a right biblical understanding of stuff, of work, so that we can live our lives so that others would stand in awe of you. Oh God, help us to give ourselves to you so that people would see our good deeds and praise you, the only one worthy of all the glory and honor and praise. To you be the glory, King Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, again, check out the bulletin to see things that are upcoming. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Grace and peace to you. You are dismissed.